Hello and welcome to Alfons Zeilais. My name is Johanna Nagelsbach. I am the grandniece of Alfons Zeilais. Alfons Zeilais was a well-known artist during his time. His life spanned from the imperial era through two world wars to the Federal Republic of Germany. In this video, I will briefly introduce you to the life of this fascinating artist and his work. If you would like to know more about Alfons Zeilais and the life during his time, check back often. I will show you a lot of original pictures and documents and tell you a lot of details about Alfons Zeilais and the life during his time.
When Alfons Zeilais is born, the German Empire, the first German national state, is just 16 years young. The Kingdom of Bavaria is a federal state of the German Empire. At that time, the Palatinate also belongs to the Kingdom of Bavaria. Alfons Zeilais will spend his life in the Kingdom of Bavaria. He has different stations there, starting at Havenlohe, Würzburg, Nürnberg, Munich, Mannheim, and finally Neustadt. Let's start in Havenlohe. Havenlohe is located on the River Main, a little north of what is now the A3 motorway, near what is now the Wertheim village outlet. Isn't it idyllic here? Wait, don't I hear a steam train? Let's go to the other side of the River Main, to the railway station. There is the workplace of Alfons' father, August Zeilais, the Royal Bavarian Railway Expeditor. The station has just been built and is important for transporting the old oaks from the nearby forest desert all over the world by train. A great job for Father August, and the best prerequisites for a career in the future logistics industry. A sawmill instead of birdsong. Father August makes a career. After a few years, the family moves to Würzburg. Würzburg is a residential and episcopal city and has been a university city since 1402. It's already much quieter here. Oh yes, the many churches and not least St. Kilian's Cathedral. Alfons went to school in Würzburg and wrote about himself. My personal preference turned very early to painting with watercolors and pastels, which influenced my other achievements at the grammar school. In Würzburg it was clear. Alfons Zeilais would become an art teacher. Alfons must have successfully completed the grammar school, otherwise it would not have been possible for him to study to become a teacher. What sounds so normal today was by no means a matter of course back then. A boy from the middle class was supposed to take the A-levels to become a teacher. In 1900, there were 5.7 million primary school pupils, but only about 180,000 grammar school pupils. Of these, only 1 in 10 took up university studies. In 1902, there were 530,000 students in the German Reich, actually in the male form, because women were not allowed to study at least until 1908. On the 1st of October 1904, Alfons Zeilais began his studies at the School of Arts and Crafts in Nuremberg, with the aim of becoming a drawing teacher at secondary schools. In the 2 years he spent in Nuremberg, he showed that he had a perfect command of perspective, accurate drawing and painting in a variety of techniques. His teacher, Professor Beck Kran, was so convinced of him that he advised him to attend the Munich Academy of Fine Arts. So Alfons Zeilais left Nuremberg and enrolled at the Academy of Fine Arts in Munich in the winter semester of 1906. This was in no way a matter of course. Not everyone was accepted there. The famous expressionist Emil Nolde did not make it into the academy. At the turn of the century, it was, next to Paris, the art academy par excellence, and attracted students from all over the world. To Together with 10 other fellow students, Alfons Zeilais enrolled in the von Hackel Drawing School. Gabriel von Hackel was not just anyone. He sent such famous students as Max Slevogt and Franz Marc on their artistic way. Of the 10 fellow students, 2 were Swiss, 1 Italian, the famous painter, sculptor and graphic artist Giorgio de Chirico, who will later be seen as the main representative of metaphysical painting, 1 Austrian, 2 Greeks, both of whom became famous, a Hungarian, a Bulgarian, a Hessian from Fulda, and a Munich resident. 7 of the 10 fellow students have left artistic traces. You can trace them on the website alfonszeilais.de. In this high-caliber environment, the 4 documented prizes that Alfons Zeilais won at the Academy, which also included money, cannot be valued highly enough. In addition to the drawing class with von Hackel, Alfons Zeilais also attended the painting class with von Marr and von Herterich, and the composing class with Professor Becker Gundahl, whose first composer student he became. In Munich, it was almost inevitable to come into contact with modern art movements. Ludwig von Herterich, professor of Alfons Zeilais, was a member of the Munich Secession. Modern French painters were exhibited in the Pinacothèque, to the displeasure of the conservative Prince Regent Leopold, who loved history painting. Monet, Manet, Degas, Renoir, artists who are today, of course, among the best, most famous, and of course most expensive, were despised at the time, and their pictures were described as unfinished and sketchy. German artists spoke out against the acquisition of such inferior foreign art. Alfons Zeilais clearly opted for modern, as can be seen in the pictures he painted, for example, in the Dachau Painters Group. In 1908, Alfons Zeilais completed his teacher training but continued his studies at the academy. At the end of the 19th century, more visual artists lived in Munich than in Vienna and Berlin combined. For Alfons Zeilais, Munich was the place for his development, even if he had to paint Nymphenburg porcelain to earn money for it. After all, Auguste Renoir was also a porcelain painter. Even though he earned little and the artist's life was hard, this period was the most artistically formative and best time of his life. It was abruptly ended by the outbreak of the war on 28th of July 1914. On 20th of August 1914, Alfons Zeilais volunteered for military service in what was to become the First World War. After military training, he went to the front, and as early as 16th of June 1915, this took him to the military hospital, where he spent a year. At least he came back to Munich during his time in the military hospital and was able to plan his next steps. There were close connections between the Palatinate and the Munich art scene. These close contacts enabled him to find his way to the boarding school Realanstalt am Donnersberg as an art teacher. So Alfons Zeilais moved to Mannheim. Today the area is still very idyllic and, as then, agricultural with no sawmills. There was even a railway station which is still supplied with tracks today. Of course, this helped enormously when completing the practical training in Kaiserslautern, which was indispensable for becoming a civil servant. At the end of the 19th century, the Realanstalt am Donnersberg was considered one of the most important boarding schools in the Palatinate. In 1902, the new assembly hall was completed, so Alfons Zeilais worked in what was then a state-of-the-art institution. It was in Mannheim that Alfons Zeilais met Elisabeth Fleischmann. According to family accounts during the 1970s, Elisabeth was an extremely intelligent, empathetic, cheerful and smart woman, who made a great impression on those around her. She also quickly became a model for Alfons' paintings. The fact that Elizabeth was a Protestant probably did not impress Alphonse. Elizabeth and Alphonse married during the First World War on 31st of July 1918. On 1st of April 1920, Alphonse Zeilis is appointed grammar school drawing teacher at the Humanistic Grammar School in Neustadt an der Weinstraße. The railway leads directly there from Mannheim. The material foundations for the family's upkeep are now in place. Daughter Anneliese is born on the 22nd of January 1922. Anneliese is baptized a Protestant. This is astonishing and must have had considerable consequences for Alphonse Zeilis, if church was important to him in any way. Marrying a Protestant as a Catholic and baptizing his daughter Protestant was usually punishable by excommunication. It is not known exactly when the Zeilis family started living in Neustadt. In 1924, Alphonse Zeilis painted a view of Neustadt. He probably already lived in Neustadt at that time. In 1922, the Palatinate art working group APK was founded. It began its activities in 1924 with the aim of promoting Palatinate art and artists through exhibitions and the sale of paintings. From 1925 onwards, Alphonse Zeilis became increasingly active as an artist. From 1926, he takes part in APK exhibitions. From 1924, after the fall of the customs border of the territories occupied by France after the First World War, exhibitions are possible again. Alphonse Zeilis is of course mentioned by name alongside the well-known Palatine artists such as Hans Purmann, Otto Dill and the Croissants. Of particular interest is an exhibition review of the 1927 exhibition in Landau on the painting Stubaiwelle. This picture is in no way conspicuous from today's point of view. The Rheinpfälzer newspaper called Alphonse Zeilis a gifted artist who would have strayed into Kokoschkaian confusion in this picture. From today's perspective, definitely praise. Hermann Croissant, an APK colleague, exhibits 13 paintings in this exhibition, while Alphonse Zeilis exhibits only one. And this shows very clearly the difference between the professional painter who has to live from the sale of his paintings and the art teacher who cannot and does not have to be so productive. The same year, a review of the Christmas exhibition writes, "It is a pleasing sign that portrait painting is again gradually being cultivated more alongside landscape, animal piece and still life." Zeilis shows three portraits, a self-portrait of great liveliness in characteristics and expression, only larger than life, which is somewhat disturbing. Furthermore, two portraits of girls which are executed with great independence and individuality of coloring. Alphonse Zeilis demonstrably painted in the open air. Sometimes he also painted in the studio after taking a photo, as here for example, either because the subject did not want to sit still or because he was like Renoir, who was critical of painting in full sunlight. Outdoors, Renoir said, no tone seemed strong enough. Back in the studio, it was all black. This was Renoir's comment to the art dealer Vollard. Until 1929, Alphonse Zeilis traveled with or without his family, which was reflected in his paintings. Elizabeth and Anneliese are motifs in many pictures. Another person is also frequently visible. Elizabeth Nagelsbach. We will talk about this woman in another section. She was Anneliese's cousin. In the 1920s, she emigrated to China, where she married Hans Meyer, a merchant from Hamburg, in a happy arranged marriage, and lived in Hong Kong until the 1950s. In China, she became a vegetarian. She and her brother Wilhelm joined the family on numerous excursions to the Palatinate Forest. The family has now found its place in Neustadt. In 1929, world history intervenes again, and brings the Golden Twenties to an abrupt end. At the end of October 1929, the stock market crashes in New York, followed by the worldwide economic crisis that lasts well into the 1930s. Germany is also badly affected. Art is no longer in demand. The APK passes a resolution that only artists who pursue art as their main occupation may participate in APK exhibitions. In 1930, Alfons Zeilis takes part once again in an exhibition, which is not for sale, however, but as an accompanying program to the event Thousand Years of Fashion and Literature. It was to be 18 years before the next exhibition at which Alfons Zeilis would exhibit. Alfons Zeilis painted little in the following years. In 1932, Elizabeth Zeilis inherited a sum of money that enabled the family to buy a plot of land. The family builds a house on the Hambacher Höhe near Neustadt-Weinstraße. The house is completed in 1933. The family can move in. On 30th of January 1933, Adolf Hitler is appointed Reich Chancellor. And on 1st of February, the Reichstag is dissolved. All organizations are brought into line as of 9th of March 1933. The APK is transferred to the Reich Chamber of Culture, the RKK. Alfons Zeilis is now forced also to be a member of the RKK. As early as 1922, Hitler wrote in Mein Kampf that what he calls ugly art belongs in medical custody, in a suitable institution because it represents a danger to the healthy sense of the people. On 23rd of March 1933, he proclaimed, "Blood and race will again become the source of artistic intuition," whatever that means. Impressionism and Expressionism are now considered un-German. Among the artists later removed from German museums as degenerate and exhibited as cautionary examples in the 1937 Degenerate Art Exhibition were famous and recognized names such as Max Beckmann, Marc Chagall, Louis Corinth, Otto Dix, Lionel Feininger, Alexei von Jawlensky, Ernst Ludwig Kirchner, Paul Klee, Oskar Kokoschka, Paula Modersohn-Becker and Pablo Picasso, to name but a few. Art has political function and now only serves politics. Art is gigantic and brutal. It shows omnipotence internally and externally. National Socialist art, as shown at the German art exhibition in the Munich Glass Palace in 1938, is heroic, monumental, prototypical, powerful, realistic. Alfons Zeilis no longer exhibits. He paints his pictures only for himself. In January 1939, he was appointed Professor of Studies. On the 1st of September 1939, Adolf Hitler let the war break out, which became the Second World War. Anneliese had a boyfriend in the meantime. Of course, the boyfriend was drafted into the army after the war began. He did not return from the war. Anneliese never married. In 1940, she graduated from high school. Her male classmates had to join the military. To ensure the exchange of information, the class set up a central office through which the class wanted to stay in touch. This worked very well without any social media. Check out my channel, I'll tell you more about it there. While the men went off to war, Anneliese went into the Reichslabor Service. The Reichslabor Service was supposed to educate German youth in the spirit of National Socialism to the national community and the true concept of work beyond social classes. No studies at university were possible without Reichslabor Service. In 1941, as every year, a large German art exhibition was held in the Haus der Deutschen Kunst in Munich, which is the new Glass Palace. What drove Alfons Zeilis to enter 3 oil paintings and 2 watercolors there is completely unknown. In any case, they were not exhibited. And he did not receive any feedback either. What is clear is that his paintings were neither heroic nor monumental, but rather impressionistic. In December, the painter Alfons Zeilis received the following letter from Mr. Hoffmann of the Reichskulturkammer. Pursuant to paragraph 1 of the order on the distribution of inferior art products of October 1, 1940, I decree that the sale, distribution and reproduction of products of painting, sculpture and graphic art or their reproductions by you require my permission. Since some of your products have been submitted to the Committee for the Evaluation of Inferior Art Products, I prohibit you, with immediate effect, from selling, distributing or reproducing your pictures in accordance with paragraph 2.1 of the order. Game of the Skies, early spring day, which I will have seized by the police authority in accordance with paragraph 2.3 of the said order. At the same time, in accordance with paragraph 2.2 of the aforementioned order, I make it a condition that all your products, before you transmit them to the public, will in future be submitted to the aforementioned committee. What a shock. Alfons Zeilis receives empty frames back. Later he painted both pictures again. Superb pictures, but completely missing the National Socialist ideal. It is unknown whether this shock was the cause or other factors. From 18th of August 1942, Alfons Zeilis is on sick leave and is not on duty until 1st of January 1943. On 22nd of November 1942, his mother died in Würzburg. By the end of the war, he had painted only 5 pictures. This may be due to the destruction of his paintings. It was certainly also not easy to get hold of the necessary material. Meanwhile, daughter Anneliese starts working at the Adler Apotheke, a pharmacy in Ludwigshafen, and eventually goes on to study pharmacy. After the war, it was almost impossible for women to get a place at university because of the large number of men returning home from the war. How fortunate that she began her studies during the war. On 7th of May 1945, Germany surrendered unconditionally. The Palatinate is occupied by the Americans. Americans? It's common knowledge that the Palatinate was occupied by the French. It was, but only later. The Americans invaded first. In May 1945, the inhabitants of Hambach were ordered to make their radio equipment available to the Americans. Alfons Zeilis goes to Würzburg to visit his family. Shortly before the end of the war, on 16th of March 1945, Würzburg was attacked by the British Royal Air Force. The historic old town where the Zeilis family lived was almost completely destroyed. From July 1945, the Americans handed over the Palatinate to the French. In 1945, we were in a time when many people were missing or prisoners of war, when many refugees were on the move in Germany, and when many people had lost their homes because they had been destroyed by bombs. The Nagelsbach family had taken shelter in the Zeilis family's house after they had been bombed out in 1944. Johanna Nagelsbach was the sister of Elisabeth Zeilis. On 7th of November 1945, French soldiers stood in front of the house of the Zeilis family and demanded that the residents vacate the house immediately. They were only allowed to take the most necessary clothes and had to leave immediately. On 8th of November 1945, only one day later, an inventory was drawn up, showing that everything a family would otherwise need to live had to be left behind in the house. Everything, including quilts, bed linen, crockery, books, sheet music, etc., remained in the house. The Silas family home had been spared from the bombs. Now it was confiscated. When a house was bombed out, at least those things that were undamaged could still be taken. This confiscation included everything. The Zeilers family was homeless from one day to the next. Relatives in the village Sembach took the family in. The story that follows could fill hours. I will tell you later more about it on this channel. Elizabeth and Alfons Zeilers had already experienced the First World War. Alfons Zeilers had experienced hardship. Through the next years, his strength and perseverance and his ability to survive in the here and now proved itself. Today, this would probably be called resilience. After a period in Sembach, the family moved into various emergency quarters, with Anneliese standing on her own 2 feet after completing her studies. It was difficult to store Alfons' paintings, the conditions were cramped, life took place in makeshift quarters. Zeilers did not paint in 1946, but from 1947 he painted again, and as early as 1948, Alfons Zeilers was once more an APK member of the re-established Arbeitsgemeinschaft Pfälzer Künstler, and again regularly took part in exhibitions. 1949, Alfons Zeilers retired. Alfons Zeilers had to fight to return the house until 30th of June 1954. The number of letters is enormous. On this date, the house is returned to Alfons Zeilers almost 9 years after it was confiscated. It takes until 1957 for all the damage to the house to be repaired and the compensation to be finally settled. In 1954, Anneliese Zeilers leases a pharmacy in Kirchheim am Neckar. Alfons and Elizabeth visit her often. On 14th of October 1962, Alfons Zeilers writes to his daughter, who is on holidays. He's quite excited because he has received an invitation to an exhibition of the Büsselart Artists Guild near Pforzheim and asks her to help him transport the paintings. The exhibition runs until 31st of January 1963. He asks Anneliese to collect the paintings again. Elizabeth Zeilers dies on 22nd of February 1963. By this time, Alfons was also seriously ill. He follows his wife on the 25th of March 1963. Anneliese Zeilers is very busy with the pharmacy at this time. After a while, she sells the house. From 1988 to 1991, Anneliese Zeilers facilitates 5 solo exhibitions with Alfons Zeilers and provides paintings for a group exhibition. Karl Ritter concludes his article on Alfons Zeilers in the Donnersberg Yearbook 1991. Looking at all the painter's pictures, we feel it as great luck that Zeilers painted beyond all isms. He painted what he saw, but he did not depict. He made visible what his senses recognized in nature through the wheel of his soul. Edgar Allan Poe.
There is so much more to tell about Alfons Zeilers and his time. How did people live? What did they eat? What did they read? How did they spend their free time? Where did artists get the paint to paint? With the help of numerous original documents and pictures from this time, I would like to take you on a journey through time into the world of Anneliese Elizabeth and Alfons Zeilers. Feel free to follow me into their world on YouTube.